In this video, we're going to talk about a few of the pitfalls that someone might encounter while they are trying to solve a quadratic equation like this. Why is it a quadratic equation? Well, it's a quadratic because it has this second degree term right over here, and it's an equation because I have something on both sides of an equal sign. So one strategy that people might try is, well, I have something squared. Why don't I just try to take the square root of both sides? And if you did that, you would get the square root of x squared plus 4x plus 3 is equal to the square root of negative 1. And you immediately see a few problems. Even if this wasn't a negative 1 here, that's the most obvious problem, but even if this was a positive value here, how do you simplify or how do you somehow isolate the x over here? You've pretty quickly hit a dead end. So just willy-nilly taking the square root of both sides of a quadratic is not going to be too helpful. So I'll put a big X over there. Another strategy that sometimes people will try to go for is to isolate the x squared first. So you can imagine, let me just rewrite it, x squared plus 4x plus 3 is equal to negative 1. They might say, let's isolate that x squared by subtracting 4x from both sides and subtracting 3 from both sides. And then what happens? On the left-hand side, you do indeed isolate the x squared. And on the right-hand side, you get negative 4x minus 4. And now someone might say, if I take the square root of both sides, I could get, and I'll just write that down, square root of x squared is equal to, and you could try to take the plus or minus of one side to make sure you're hitting the negative roots, negative 4x minus 4. And you could get something like this. You would get x is equal to plus or minus the square root of negative 4x minus 4, but this still doesn't help you. You still don't know what x is, and it's really not clear what to do with this algebraically. So this is yet another dead end. Now, there's some cases in which this strategy would have worked. In fact, it would have worked if you did not have this first degree term, if you did not have this x term, so to speak. Then this strategy would have worked, assuming that there are some solutions. But if you have an x term like this, and it doesn't cancel out somehow, you know, if there was another 4x on the other side, then you could subtract 4x from both sides and they would disappear. But if you can't make these things disappear, this strategy that I've just outlined is not going to be a productive one. Now, another strategy that you'll sometimes see people use, especially when they see something like this, let me rewrite it, x squared plus 4x plus 3 is equal to negative 1, they immediately go into factoring mode. They say, hey, wait, I think I might be able to factor this. I can think of two numbers that add up to 4 and whose product is 3, maybe 3 and 1. And then they immediately factor this left-hand expression, say that's going to be x plus 3 times x plus 1, and then that's going to be equal to negative 1. And then they either are about to make a mistake, this is actually algebraically valid, but they either make a mistake or they realize that they're at a dead end. Because just saying that something times something is equal to negative 1 doesn't help you a ton, because it's not clear yet how you would solve for x. Another thing try to do is they'll immediately say, okay, therefore x is equal to negative 3 or x is equal to negative 1, because negative 3 will make this first term 0 and negative 1 or negative 1would make the second term 0. But remember, this would only be true if you're multiplying two things and you got 0 as their product. Then the solutions would be anything that made either one of those terms equal to 0. But that's not what we're dealing with here. Here we're taking the product as equal to negative 1. So in order to factor like this and make headway in most cases, you're going to want to have a 0 on the right-hand side over here. And that's also true if you're trying to apply the quadratic formula. A lot of folks would say, okay, I see a quadratic equation right over here. Let me just apply the quadratic formula. They say if I have something of the form ax squared plus bx plus c is equal to 0, the quadratic formula would say that the roots are going to be x is equal to negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac, all of that over 2a. And so they'll immediately say, all right, I can recognize a here as just being a 1. There's a 1 coefficient implicitly there. B is 4, c is 3. And then they'll say, okay, x is equal to negative 4 plus or minus the square root of b squared, which is 16, minus 4 times 1 times 3, all of that over 2 times 1. But there's a problem. The quadratic formula applies when the left-hand side is equal to 0. That's not what we have over here. So we're falling into that same pitfall. So everything I just did none of this is a good idea. So the way to approach this, if you want 0 over here, you want to add 1 on the right-hand side. And if you want to maintain the equality, you have to add a 1 on the left-hand side. And so you're going to get x squared plus 4x plus 4 is equal to 0. And now you could use a quadratic formula, or you could factor. You might recognize 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. 2 times 2 is equal to 4. So you could say x plus 2 times x plus 2 is equal to 0. And so in this case, you say, all right, x could be equal to negative 2, or x could be equal to negative 2. So this one only has one solution. X is equal to negative 2. But the key is to recognize that you need the 0 on the right-hand side there. If you want to use a quadratic formula, or if you want to use factoring and the zero product property.